Now, goblin spiders are very, very small. They're a little bit hard to find. You've got to get on down on your hands and knees in forest leaf litter around the world to find them. But when we do find them, they're remarkable little animals. The specimens of this new species came from Horn Island in the Torres Strait in North Queensland. At the moment, they're only known from this single island, but we imagine that probably surveys in the local area will turn up additional specimens. If anybody wants to send Barbara and I to the Horn Island, we could probably take Sir David with us. I'm sure he doesn't mind scrabbling around looking for spiders. But these specimens were first collected in the 1980s by Queensland Museum staff. And as usual with a lot of museum collections, especially with invertebrate animals, they were sitting in the vaults of the museum waiting to be discovered. And that's when Barbara came along and started looking at the spiders. Now, goblin spiders are small. They're very small. This particular species is extremely small. It's 1.04 millimetres in length. And we've got the actual specimen in the jar, which we can get out shortly. I hope you've all got your reading glasses on. I'm giving you that behind them as well. Now, of course, we shouldn't really anthropomorphise between ourselves and things like spiders, but Sir David, there are three defining features of this species. So please don't take this the wrong way. One is that it's got smaller eyes than most other species. We presume it doesn't see quite as well as most of its ancestors. And regrettably, it has quite different genitalia to all the other species in the genus. So we won't take that any further. We didn't have children. And shortly I asked Sir David to point out the most defining feature which Barbara found when she described the species was a lateral process on the clypeus, so I'll ask you to point that out as well. Now, life on Earth, to use the title of Sir David's groundbreaking documentary and book, is a never-ending tapestry of diversity that continually throws up surprises, even for those of us hardened by years, literally years of staring down a microscope. And each time we find a new species, it's literally a small eureka moment, helping to put together a staggeringly large jigsaw puzzle to help document 4 billion years of evolution. Now, Barbara and I couldn't think of a more fitting person to name this species for. I avidly read your ZooQuest books as a kid in the 1960s by borrowing them from our local library. I'm discovering Agatha Christie novels at the same time. And luckily, I became a biologist and not a detective trying to solve murders. And later in my life, I was totally enthralled by your documentary, starting with Life on Earth in 1979. I think we can safely say that you've inspired an entire generation, or two, or three, by making natural history accessible in our living rooms. So from all of us in love with nature, thank you.
Giving one's name to a species, of course, is the ultimate compliment from the scientific community for anybody. Now, Harry Butler has got 60. But not in that lead. But I do have a few. Atapiscids. Well, a bit of a problem. A go-go fish from the Devonian. The first with internal fertilization, as they discovered from the fossil, and which had the young was developing, and actually had them among the lipocorbic in the shell. Of course, this implies copulation. So this is the first copulator known in the history of the world, and called my name. I did ponder on this as to the degree of compliment involved. I remember going to Gogo absolutely vividly. Gogo, as you know, was first identified by scientists from London, from the Natural History Museum. And they went there and they scooped up all these nodules and all these Devonian fish in and took them away to London. And when I thought we ought to film this particular site, and I came down here, I discovered that this wasn't altogether a population, popular sort of move as far as people in this part of the world is concerned. And so I said, could we have permission to go to Gogo? And I'm not sure who it was, but it may have been someone. I think it was a mistake. And they said, no, I said, well, I want to fill the site. And he said, there's nothing there. It's clearly a lie. And I said, even so, I would like to film there. And he was very reluctantly. He said, you blokes, he said, came from London. You scooped up all the obvious stuff and did the, you know, the big flashy stuff. You left us to clear up the mess after you blokes had left. And we've now removed everything so there's no scene. But if you want to go, you can go, but I'm coming with you. So we got to a helicopter and we landed in Gogo. And I got out and I put my foot on a block of stone. On the stone there was a rectangular shape with venation on it, unlike anything I'd ever seen before in my life. And I picked it up and I sent it to my scientific guide. And I said, what on earth is that? And he said, you bug. What I produced at a pond, and once again, returned to Gogo and produced one of the fossils that Australians had missed. And indeed, it was one of these dermal scutes from one of those very big armour ships, which sits in my living room to this day, as my daughter will testify, as one of the great things. So, Western Australia means a lot to me, actually. The first time I came, well, it was on the same trip, actually, it was a long time ago now. We drove from here up north to Hamlin Pool in Shark Bay. And at that time, those stromatolites were really not very well recognized in the world as being what they are, which is the very, very origin of life. And those stromatolites now, I think, every textbook has them as being an example of where, of how life began in these oceans. So West, and that drive up the West Coast was a dawning of a new perception. The splendor of the West Australian flora simply blew my mind. Day after day, we drove through these wonderful flower fields of wildflowers. The identity of which I, of course, have no idea. It's an extraordinary place which I really, truly treasure in my heart, my times I spend here, rivaled only by Queensland. I can go on record, this is not just for this occasion. People ask me again and again, where is your favourite place from a natural point of view of the world? And I nearly always say, well, I always say, Cape York. The splendour of Cape York blows the mind, and the time I spent in that rainforest and the time down going onto the reef. So those are the two sides of Australia, and they have a great place in my heart. That I have the population of the inhabitant of one of them is a matter named after me, is a matter of great delight. I've said to my daughter and my son, when I stop travelling, I think what I'm going to do is start really trying to look at spiders and make sense of them. It seemed to me that the most rivetingly interesting of invertebrates. I once made a film entirely about spiders and other silk spinners. There is one, you know, a bolas spider, which I'm talking about in North America. And I'm not there when the couple of dozen cameramen work on some of these programs, so I go from one to the other. They will go ahead of me and do some work. And I explained to the cameraman that the bolas spider saw this when it approached it. The moth had this long filament of silk at the bottom, and it whirled through it and caught these visiting what we might. That's what we might say. So I turned up after he'd been working for about a week. And he took me down, and he had about a dozen milk bottles, in each of which there was a sprig of leaves on it. And each one of them had a spider. All the same species, all bolas spider. And he took me another one, and he said, "This one hates light. If you get a flick of light, won't join it at all. This one, for some reason, is very sensitive to noise. If you can't film that, you can do fine, but then the sun makes noise, it'll stop. This one doesn't seem to do anything at all, useless. But this one is an absolute darling. She will go on wearing the bonus. No matter what you're doing, what you're saying, or what you're doing, or what you're doing." Now, what did that teach me? That taught me that these tiny little fibers, less than the size of my fingernail, have individual personalities. Isn't that astounding? I'm not sure about this. It is evidence judgment, merciless. Certainly beautiful, but I will check it. And I thank you very much indeed for this. It is, as I said to start, naming a species is the biggest of compliments that you could ask from any scientific community. And I truly thank you very, very much indeed for this one.